This isn't my usual style, but I was asked to go a little more in depth in this book, Introduction to Mathematical Philosophy by Bertrand Russell. This is a reprint of the second edition of the book, which was printed originally in 1920. The preface talks about that this is an introduction and discusses the idea of what is being called philosophy. We see this quote that says, "Much of what is set forth in the following chapters is not properly to be called philosophy, though the matters concerned were included in philosophy so long as no satisfactory science of them existed." And then, as we go on to the editor's note, there's the discussion about whether this is mathematical philosophy or the philosophy of mathematics. And then we get to the contents. The contents list the chapters here. First chapter being the series of natural numbers. Chapter 2 is definition of number. 3 is finitude and mathematical induction. 4 is the definition of order. 5 is kinds of relations. 6 is similarity of relations. 7 is rational, real, and complex numbers. 8 is infinite cardinal numbers. 9 is infinite series and ordinals. 10 is limits and continuity. 11 is limits and continuity of functions. 12 is selections in the multiplicative axiom. 13, the axiom of infinity and logical types. Chapter 14, incompatibility and the theory of deduction. 15, propositional functions. 16, descriptions. 17, classes. And chapter 18, mathematics and logic. The chapters, in some way, could be read independently, especially if you've already read the book. But if you're reading through it the first time, I would suggest reading through in order because some of the material does refer back to discussions in previous chapters. This really gives a challenge to think about ideas in mathematics that we probably have an idea of, or that is taught in certain ways, and then really looking at where the foundation of those ideas lay. Chapter 2 is the definition of number, which is a pretty common question to ask is, what is number? Where does it come from? We will see many times throughout the text that there is references to other works in here. One thing that is commonly referenced is Principia Mathematica. The Principia Mathematica that is referenced in here was the book that was co-authored with Russell by Whited, and it was published by the Cambridge University Press. There are 3 volumes listed, published in 1910, 1911, and 1913. It is a little bit difficult for me to summarize this book. It really is deep. Some takeaways that I had from this book was discussion of the development of the idea of the codomain, understanding a difference between a number and a class that has a number of items in there, and how those concepts should be looked at differently. We see this development of relations, and that is a common topic in mathematics. This diagram here is a very common type of diagram seen in mathematics as we discuss different concepts in higher mathematics. In the rational, real, and complex numbers chapter, we see this development of the idea of addition and multiplication of complex terms. I don't know if everyone watching is familiar with this particular algorithm for multiplication. I've seen it in one of my graduate level classes. I'm not sure if I had seen it before that or not, but I see it in this text. Ideas of infinite cardinal numbers and the development of transfinite cardinal numbers based on Georg Cantor's work is discussed in here and is an important topic. We see some of these important discussions about what it means to add something to a set that is countably infinite, what it means to take a countably infinite set to a power, what it means to take that countably infinite set and make it the exponent of a number. We have this statement by Russell here saying, but the proofs hitherto offered by Cantor and others, including the present author in former days, are fallacious, for reasons which will be explained when we come to consider the multiplicative axiom. So he talks about proofs in the past having some errors in them, including his own proofs. And he talks about the multiplicative axiom, and this comes up later. It's another one of those concepts that is discussed here and really makes you think about what we mean when we say certain things in mathematics and what the expectations are. As we get into the chapter on limits and continuity, we start to see some of our modern ideas of analysis being discussed. One thing that I marked here in this chapter, limits and continuity, that was something I thought was important was the notions of limit and continuity, which we have been defining, must not be confounded with the notions of the limit of a function for approaches to a given argument, or the continuity of a function in the neighborhood of a given argument. So he's saying that when he's talking about limit and continuity in general, it's not the same as the idea of a limit of a function or continuity of a function that we might think of as we think of calculus and analysis. This following chapter, he talks about limits and continuity of functions. I like this statement here that he makes, that epsilon is some number which, in important cases, will be very small. So that's kind of interesting the way that he stated that. Once we get here to chapter 12, we see that the multiplicative axiom is in the title. So we have a heads up that we are going to be looking at that idea in this chapter. So one of the things he states here as we start to get into this chapter is that multiplication with the number of factors being finite is not difficult. That's not the issue that he's having a problem with. His problem, as we move down the page, is multiplication when the number of factors may be infinite. He's seen this as a problem that needs to be looked at, and we want to establish this as a rigorous idea. As we get to chapter 13, we see he mentions the axiom of infinity in the chapter title. His illustration for showing what he calls an arithmetical catastrophe starts here on page 132. Suppose there were exactly 9 individuals in the world. As to what is meant by the word individual, I must ask the reader to be patient. Then the inductive cardinals from 0 up to 9 would be such as we expect, but 10, defined as 9 plus 1, would be the null class. It will be remembered that n plus 1 may be defined as follows. N plus 1 is the collection of all those classes which have a term x such that when x is taken away, there remains a class of n terms. Now, applying this definition, we see that in the case supposed 9 plus 1 is a class consisting of no classes, it is the null class. The same will not be true of 9 plus 2, or generally of 9 plus n, unless n is 0. Thus, 10 and all subsequent inductive cardinals will all be identical, since they will all be the null class. In such a case, the inductive cardinals will not form a progression, nor will it be true that no two have the same successor, for 9 and 10 will both be succeeded by the null class, 10 being itself the null class. Then we have the summary statement. It is in order to prevent such arithmetical catastrophes that we require the axiom of infinity. Of course, from this point on, we go into his further discussions about the ideas that he wants to discuss and try to make rigorous. As we get into chapter 14, we see the title Incompatibility and the Theory of Deduction. We know deduction and induction are important topics to discuss in mathematics. We see in this chapter some of the classic elementary logic ideas of P sub 1 implies that P sub 2 implies P sub 3. Just of interest, historically, we see the difficulty of the typesetting at the time for the mathematical notation. We move on to propositional functions. We see more of that classic elementary logic coming into play. In the propositional functions chapter here, one of the things that I underlined that I found interesting was his statement that, in fact, however, there was never any clear account of what was added to truth by the conception of necessity. It's interesting, chapter 16, descriptions, we see that it opens saying that this chapter we will consider the word the in the singular, and in the successive chapter we're going to see the word the in the plural form. So that's the kind of depth we're looking at when we look at Bertrand Russell getting to the foundational ideas in mathematics. We have two chapters on what the is going to mean to us. If you are in to mathematics, and you really need to understand deep levels of mathematics, especially if you are proof writing and dealing with the strict ideas of logic in mathematics, this is a nice book to get into, to wrap your mind around just how deep you can go with establishing your foundation and being rigorous, and use it as a cautionary idea and potentially as a jumping point to make sure that you are getting an understanding that you need to have to have the rigorous logic that you need in your mathematics. I know this may not be quite the level of depth that some people wanted, but it is more in depth than the short preview that I gave earlier. This is a good read if you are a student of mathematics and you're doing proof writing. If you're trying to understand where the foundational parts of mathematics lie, this is also something for you. It's something that you're going to have to be willing to think deeply about. I hope you find some mathematics in your part of the world that you're enjoying and can share with others. Cheerful Calculations.